So it depends on when you get someone with sepsis, when, at what stage, what expression you are going to get, and this is what we usually grapple with. So I wouldn't go through this entire thing, but what the point I'd like to make is that when we have a child with sepsis, we do not want to get them at this end of the spectrum with multi-organ failure where it's very obvious. We would like to be upstream here, where there is a local infection or signs and symptoms that are quite subtle. Because in many cases in the world, there are no ICUs with a lot of resources, and all that is available is simple treatment, some oxygen, antibiotics, some fluid, maybe some minimal respiratory support. The other issue with children is that, this is a study from Kenya that shows that most of the death from those children who are bacteremic, they come very early within the first day, almost 75%. So therefore, if you are going to make a difference in their lives, you've got to make a diagnosis again, as I said, very early and go upstream. The problem is that many of the children arrive later on when it's obvious and when treatment does not make much of a difference. And the setting that the context in which many of these children present are large crowded waiting areas. They compete with adults for care. There's a lot of young kids, as you can see. And the point is that, again, that in those situations, we have to be able to pick up the children with sepsis very early. In many cases, what we fail is we fail with having good triage mechanisms to identify those who are ill and needed. And then there are vulnerable populations. The children who present unimmunized with meningitis, malnutrition, post-operative patients, and the issue of zoonosis, animals being in close proximity to these children, also put them at risk. So in areas in which there are no diagnostic tests and no sophisticated laboratory, and as we heard, many of the diagnostic tests do not really help us very early on, one of the ways of grappling with management of children's sepsis is the syndromic management. And this is again work from Kenya, where what they were trying to do is identify children who were critically ill in need of early antibiotic therapy, and they were using observable criteria, things they can observe with minimal or no laboratory tests. And what they did in a study of looking at about almost 12,000 children, they were able to identify about 6,000 children who, in their estimation, fit the criteria, okay, a case finding for syndromic sepsis. And what they found from that group is that 12% died with a sensitivity to predict death was 93%. The rest, only 1% died, so the negative predictive value was 99%. So the usefulness of this is can be used in a resource-limited environment, but it identified not only those who were or children who were septic, but most of the children who were critically ill in those areas. And indeed, in many of those areas, most of the children who are critically ill has some form of infection. So syndromic sepsis is one way that it has been used to diagnose. In North America, this is the Society of Critical Care Medicine guideline that we've just updated recently again. We spoke about recognizing decreased mental status and perfusion as the underlying marker of someone who is in severe sepsis. But I think that gives us the idea of only when we go downstream and they have very severe sepsis. Again, I think we have to go upstream. The issue we face, I think, as I said, the first slide, what is sepsis? We said it's a time sort of sensitive issue. It depends on signs and symptoms of different areas. What we have is myocardial depression, we have endothelial dysfunction and thrombosis and bleeding, and the relative contributions of each one of these in early sepsis varies. The ultimate final sort of common pathway is failure of organ perfusion, but if we look at the contributors to this pattern, we have dengue, cholera, gastroenteritis, malaria, bacterial sepsis, mixed infections, superimpose on anemia and malnutrition, they all play into this in this triumvirate. And if we look at, say, malaria, one can see that anemia may be a major contributor. There is some endothelial dysfunction and capillary leak and mitochondrial dysfunction and acidosis. And hence, the recognition and treatment is slightly different from this sort of situation where this is dengue fever, where capillary leak, endothelial leak, and hypovolemia is a major contributor. Myocardial depression is less. Now, so how do we diagnose sepsis? And in this talk, I'm just going to concentrate on the SIRS criteria, physical examination, and lactate level, because I'm saying that in most instances where we are asked these questions, it's limited resources. So we look at the SIRS criteria in diagnosing sepsis. We know what the SIRS criteria is. In children, it is slightly modified, where we have at least two of the following, and we say one of which must be abnormal temperature or leukocyte count. The fact is that in many parts of the world now, and in fact we are doing some studies in Uganda that is showing that if you choose temperature and heart rate and respiratory rate only, tachycardia and tachypnea, without a leukocyte count, the sensitivity does not really change much, needed as a specificity. And in areas in which leukocyte count is difficult to get, it is problematic. You heard from Conrad that even leukocyte count may not help, and we've found some of the similar data in children, which I'll come to. So you look at SIRS and neonates, and there's this recent study looking at 13 neonates with early onset sepsis, only 53% fulfilled SIRS criteria. So again, it's not very useful. And in resource-limited settings, as I said, no laboratory tests, complex organ dysfunction, and core temperature measurement precludes the use of SIRS to help us identify or point out sepsis. And this is a point prevalence study of SIRS in hospitalized children. In this study, the issue with this, with SIRS criteria, this is from Latvia. There are two time periods they looked at: children with 943 children that came into the hospital, children with fever were 92, with SIRS 66, and very few came out with having sepsis. What it showed me, and the issue that we're grappling with in my own institution and several institutions across North America, is the fact that the SIRS criteria screens a large body of children in the emergency department. We may screen thousands of children with very little yield. And to some extent, the staff gets very sort of complacent after a period of time. So SIRS may not help us. This is a study we just completed in China, 11 regional hospitals serving over 800,000 children. And we looked at 1,606 who had SIRS criteria, so sepsis or severe sepsis. The worrisome thing is that there is a group of patients, we had 79 with no SIRS, but they end up with having severe sepsis and died. So we thought the international guidelines or the international SIRS criteria, it's troublesome, and it was good to hear today that it's troublesome even in adults. You heard about Rory Stewart. I wouldn't tell you much more. Conrad mentioned it already. But this is a part of the issue, the troublesome issue, because they did a sepsis screening on Rory, but the adult criteria we use, and even with this adult criteria where the respiratory rate greater than 20 and heart rate greater than 90, those are most kids. So in this hospital, if they were using this to screen kids, it would be quite useless. But at the end of the day, they missed, his white count was high, his SEGS was high, and they missed the diagnosis. And I think part of the problem is that we know what screening should be, but again, people get complacent with it. Well, physical exam, we talk about capillary refill, and there are several issues with capillary refill. How to do it properly is an issue that even pediatrics, many people don't. So it's not surprising when you look at even shock. When a child comes in a shock that is very obvious, this is 100 consecutive children in a ward in Kenya, the train and clinical recognition of signs. But you can see the interobservable variability, moderate variability, temperature gradient. They found it reasonable, but capillary refill, weak pulse, etc., you can see it's not very, it gives you great comfort that the trainees and everyone will recognize those signs. Lactate levels, I won't say much. This is a recent study, again, in the emergency department, looking at lactate levels and inclusion criteria in those with SIRS. And the lactate level of greater than 4 was able to predict those who are going to get organ dysfunction, those sort of thing, those who are going to have a positive blood culture, those who are going to get ICU admission. But again, the overwhelming evidence is that it is not very helpful in early sepsis, and neither is it available in many parts of the world that these children are. So let us look at a few of the different ways it's used to recognize sepsis. And this is the UK. They said pediatric sepsis 6, what needs to be done? They say look at a core temperature, high or low temperature, tachycardia, altered mental status, or reduced peripheral perfusion. That is their signs and symptoms for recognition. This is one from Texas, and again, you can see there are some high-risk patients with oncological emergencies, dyspnea, etc. But beyond that, it's very similar criteria looking at the abnormal pulse, respiratory rate, and heart rate, following these patients. This again is not one from Utah. Again, heart rate, respiratory rate, pulses, central capillary refill. And another one from Boston Children's recognize altered mental status and poor perfusion. Doesn't really help us much. And as Conrad said, there is nothing specific that you can lay your eyes on as he pointed out in cardiovascular disease, such as myocardial infarction. We have problems with signs. Medicine Sans Frontières, they looked at capillary refill again, fast pulse, cold peripheries. And this is a project that we are doing in Bangladesh. Again, you can see not feeding well, feel feverish, poor feeding, feeble cry, drowsy, etc. for children and newborns with sepsis. So we have suspicion in the community, and we have a case finding form, which again incorporates hypothermia, convulsions, etc. With the neonates, we put hypothermia as one of the signs. In the older children, because so many children there are there with fever, we thought that would be overwhelming the medical system. So it's not really a very, how would I say, it's a very ideal sort of situation, but the fact is that under the circumstances in which these children present is the best that we can do. Now, ultimately, I think that you've been hearing some of the other exciting new developments. I think ultimately integration of clinical laboratory data, metabolomic, genomic, and proteomic has some sort of I would say potential, and I think would be of great benefit in the future. But at the end of the day, as we heard, it's the clinical signs and symptoms that I've just mentioned. So that's it. I'd like to thank you very much for your time.